Good morning. Welcome. We're going to start with a group exercise. In fact, I need to do this too. Pull out your mobile phones and make sure they're turned off or muted. I'm going to do that same thing. This is Friday, April 10th, and the 9 a.m. panel number 5121, Music as Sacred Ground. Good morning. I'm Bill Obermeyer, Executive Director of the Dairy Center for the Arts here in Boulder, and I'm pleased to be moderating this discussion. Given our topic today, Music as Sacred Ground, I thought a bit of irreverence in doing the introductions might be kind of interesting for this fascinating panel. So, first of all, meet David Wilcox. Three things most people don't know about David are that he has bicycled across several countries, including this one. He's really accomplished at making crepes, injera, and dosas. And he can tell you the exact year of any air-cooled VW.
That's a talented man.
That's a talented man. And speaking of that, which of the following people has Derek Nash played live with or broadcast with? Eric Clapton, Sir Paul McCartney, Solomon Burke, Roger Daltrey, Tom Jones, or Ernie Watts? All of the above. You got that right. Ernie, after Tuesday. I don't know if you guys played together before then or not.
Last year.
And he still came back.
And that takes us to Ernie Watts, who is not enamored with e-things, especially email. In fact, he's known by many as the Analog Man, which, as many of you know, is the title of one of his albums and the title of one of the songs he played Tuesday night. But there's a great quote from Ernie that says, "Music lifts the human spirit and transcends language and boundaries between people. We are all part of the same energy, and music is one of the clearest expressions of that." It's pretty neat. Now, which of the following would you imagine to be true about Adrian Ferrugia? A, his life's motto is everything in moderation, including moderation. B, aside from his life's work as a musician composer, he's also an amateur Vespa mechanic.
Yes!
C, he makes the best eggplant parmigiana you'll ever eat, or all of the above? And of course, it's all of the above.
Vespa.
And Tanya Boutte Ellsworth. Tanya has been a hair care specialist for 31 years and also an entertainer for 29 of those years. And her career summary on her LinkedIn page says, I love this, "I'm sweet but tough and fair, love my music and music loves me, and when I'm not singing to you, I'm styling your hair. But music is my life." That's our panel this morning, and we're going to begin with David Wilcox.
Let's turn this guitar up in the house. All right, this is a song that showed up fast. I couldn't have recopied it any faster than I wrote it. Do you know what I mean? I was hearing it, and I thought, I got scared when I got to that middle verse, because it was about something that I thought could derail my life. But it was wild, because in this song I'm hearing someone else speaking. So that's why I called the song Chet Baker's Unsung Swan Song. Imagine Chet looking out that window in Amsterdam. There's beautiful images around. What if he did grab the old spiral bound and write out a little lyric? I don't know a lot about Chet. I just read the liner notes. The liner notes say they don't know if he jumped or fell or was pushed, but he came out that window. Seems like all of those beautiful springtime images might have been trying to tell him how close he was to that edge. My own addiction changed the wiring in my brain so that when it turns the switches, then I am not the same. So like the flowers toward the sun, I will follow, stretch myself too thin, like there's a part of me that's already buried, that sends me out into this window. And my old addiction, it's the flood upon the land when this tiny lifeboat could keep me dry. But my weight is all that it can stand. So when I try to lean just a little, but just a splash to cool my feet, that trickle turns out fickle, fills my boat up 5 miles like this. Just this morning, songbirds, look, see how they're craving upward from the nest to see. These tiny birds outside my window, they'll take my hand to be their mom. These open mouths will just trust and swallow anything that comes along. Guess that's just me and my old addiction. Now the other side of day, as the springtime my life's time turns the other way. If a swan can have a song, I think I know that tune. But the page is only scrawl, and I am gone. This afternoon, this afternoon, but the page is only scrawl. I am gone this
get a song like that, and you get to play it to remind yourself. It's as if the song knows something I don't, and when I play it, it takes my heart there to that wisdom, but it takes it there before it's too late. So in that way, if I make a promise to myself to feel as deeply, maybe, but not
to fall as far, then that promise is indelible, because the emotion of it is held. She had a life to live. The day she left home, she vowed no surrender, no company drone. She wrote it down in crimson, she wrote it down in black, she wrote it down so deep, she's never gonna take it back. Make your clear and solemn vow before the age of compromise. Write it here and write it now, always right before your eyes. This tattoo, this tattoo, this tattoo, it isn't on the surface, it doesn't need to be. She wrote it down so deep, only she can see. She doesn't have to show it, it isn't made for show. She made the print so plain, it's written on her soul. Make your clear and solemn vow before the age of compromise. Write it here and write it now, always right before your eyes. This tattoo, this tattoo. Now with this tattoo, you make your promise of who you are and what you think. This will be your binding contract written down in blood and ink. She had a life to live. The day she left home, she vowed no surrender, no company drone. If I can show up to the empty page in the quiet room every morning and ask my heart, what do I need to know before it's too late? What do I need to speak to someone I love before it's too late? And my heart can tell me words that it couldn't find, except for the help of this subtle discernment that comes when this simple sound opens my heart and can choose and can look at two lines that are kind of true and say, this one more than that one. And there's something else about it that doesn't fit. And the fact that you have to stretch those words over music means that this language has to stretch, stretch enough to crack so the light comes through. And that is sacred ground.
Thank you, David. Gosh, that's a great beginning. Well, we're going to follow that up with Derek. Good. Derek Nash.
Good.
That was great.
Don't call it good. That's so undervaluing what you just did there.
It made me cry.
Me too.
Yeah.
So, yeah, 3 minutes and somebody knows you and knows that's sacred ground. Wow.
Probably shouldn't say this because we'll do.
Wow.
Come on. I went to Amsterdam a month ago. Had the day off. Could do anything I wanted. I walked to the Prince Hendrik Hotel and just stood there, which is the window that Chet came out of. I went to visit that sacred ground.
Yeah.
And I realised everything he'd thrown away. And all the beautiful music he'd made. And every time I listen to Chet, I hear so much. And that song, he just opened me right up. Well done. Right, come on, let's talk about some sensible stuff. That's the power of music. I remember crying when I heard Michael Brecker play solo. I thought I was the only one in the audience. He played Naima all by himself in London in the Union Chapel. Cried then. It took me a long time to learn how to cry. This is not what I was intending to say.
but it's good that you can and everyone should. Okay. My angle when I looked at this is what is sacred ground. We use this word sacred in two different ways. We use it as musicians to say, oh, this is sacred. Yeah, don't touch it. This is just perfect. But we have to look to the history of the word sacred because it always meant religious things. And I wanted to do some almost research to maybe do research because I don't play religious sacred music and I wanted it to just see if that had anything to do with the kind of music that I call sacred. So I did some research. And basically, sacred music is exclusively devoted to a deity or some religious ceremony or use wholly consecrated. So Christian music is, it says it believed that this music lay somewhere between singing and speaking, this is when it started, or speaking with an understood ritual cadence. Wow, that's not far off rap music.
Yeah.
So I then looked to the Rastafari movement. That's from the Alhambric religion, which developed in Jamaica in the 1930s, following the coronation of Haile Selassie. So, they have the spiritual use of cannabis as part of their religion. It's not far off where we are today. And reggae music is quite an important part of my life. I don't play it very often, but when I've worked with some great reggae artists, I've found it incredibly uplifting spiritual music. And reggae music includes what's called buru drumming, the buru style, which centers on three drums, the bass, the alto funde, and the repeater, which would later be copied by hip-hop DJs. Sacred music in modern contemporary music coming through. So I went to Shinto music. And this is the ceremonial and festive music of Shinto, the native religion of Japan. And its origin myth is the erotic dance of Ame no Uzume no Mikito, which lured Amaterasu from her cave. Now, if that ain't what we do on a nightly basis, is try and lure someone from our cave with jazz music. So there it is in contemporary music. And then I went to klezmer, which is sacred Jewish music, with synagogues following traditional Jewish rites. Do not employ musical instruments as part of a synagogue service. Traditional synagogue music is therefore purely vocal. The principal melodic role in that service is that the hazan, or the cantar, responses of the congregation are typically monophonic. Now that is what I call and response. And we've all been at a rock and roll gig where the singer has gone, way up and there, way up and there. Okay, Jewish klezmer music coming in on everything contemporary. And that will, of course, lead us to gospel music. And there's no way I'm going to talk about gospel music. So, I looked up a second meaning of the word sacred, and that is worthy of all regard with reverence, awe, and respect. And I think that is how I view music, with respect and awe. It's a magical thing, and it touches me, as you just did, you swine. And music can do that. I'll find myself driving in the car, and something will just turn up, and a tear will appear in my eye. And I don't know why. I can't decide why. But these combinations of mathematical frequencies somehow stir incredible emotions. So it is a sacred thing to me. And sometimes the sacred music means a dedication. Well, I think we all dedicate things. You dedicated that song to Chet Baker, Chong to Set Baker, even. And I wrote a song recently, which we didn't play. We meant to play. I gave it to Adrian yesterday. And I'm very proud of the fact that my father has been a professional musician all his life. He's 89 now. And we co-written a whole album. And even now I keep saying, send me a tune, send me a tune. And he sent me a tune recently, which I thought was magical, the first eight bars of which. And it just said waltz at the top of it. And I played it and I thought, oh, this would be great. And then I said, what would you do if you did that? He said, oh, you can't do that. And then we played around with it, and he came back to me afterwards, after I'd recorded it. He said, actually, that was a good thing we did. So we wrote the song together. But I called it Song for My Father, because I want to honour my father and the fact of all the musical heritage, the sacred things he's passed down to me. So I then started looking at quotes for sacred. And you get the same thing. Work to me is a sacred thing. Sacrifices. Nothing other than the production of sacred things. And then I found this incredible one, which blew my whole concept of sacred apart. I don't think I want to actually tell you who it was even written by. It says, the idea of the sacred is the idea of the sacred is quite simply one of the most conservative notions in any culture, because it seeks to turn other ideas, uncertainty, progress, and change, into crimes. Now, that was one of the most profound things I'd read this week. And I know who, if someone wants to know who it was written by, I'll let you know afterwards. But that, to me, then suddenly realized that he was talking about jazz and the thing I do. Because I love uncertainty. The uncertainty of us coming together yesterday, having only discussed song titles and nothing else. And then we ended up playing things that weren't on the list. The progress of the fact that throughout the week, we come together, we meet Sunday evening, Monday morning, we throw the entire concert together from scratch. It's a wonderful thing of participatory music. We all provide some of our own life and we throw it into this melting pot and we hope that others combine together. And change. Yeah, change. Every time I try and play a jazz phrase, I try and change it. Even if I can only change one note, then I've made a difference to it. So in fact, I'm maybe not playing sacred music because I'm doing all those things. Anyway, my thought is, I had other ideas about sacred music. My father would always say, the melody is sacred. And he would always get angry when he would hear instrumentalists or singers never even get the melody right at any stage. And he always said, the least you could do to be honorable to the composer of the piece of music is to at least play the melody once. Because that's what they wrote. They poured their heart into that melody. Then you can do your interpretations, your variations, but at least try and get the melody right. That was one of his bugbears. And he would say, the melody is sacred. But then again, people have taken things that were sacred and changed them. For example, tunes that I know, like Get Happy. Get Happy. The tune, the version that we all now play, the bridge in the middle, the chords are now different from the way that composer originally wrote it. It has become a different way. When Stan Getz plays Quiet Nights and Quiet Stars, he has actually chopped two bars off the end of the original melody that Jobim wrote and changed it into this new version. And we all now copy that new lyric. So maybe things shouldn't be sacred, but maybe they should be treated with the utmost respect. So maybe I should say this one. Each is under the most sacred obligation not to squander the material committed to him. I thought that was an interesting word. Not to sap his strength or folly and vice, and to see at least that he delivers a product worthy of the labor and the cost which have been expended on him. So that's how I feel about songs, treated with respect. And this whole interest in looking at sacred music and what we call sacred. I try and be sacred in my compositions whenever I write anything. I don't ever want it to go out to the world unless I'm happy with every nut and bolt of it. It has to satisfy my soul before I release it to anyone else. I don't know, do you feel the same way?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't let it out until you're happy with it. Yeah. And people often say to me, you know, I have spent all this week with lovely, amazing people coming up and saying, wow, yeah, Tuesday was great, you played fantastic. And it's a weird thing from within my soul. If I don't think I played well, I don't think I played well. And I think you'll find it's a weird thing with musicians. We don't think we play well very often. I think I did a good job and I was okay, but there were some bits that I was really angry with myself for doing and really upset. And I think, but actually, when I talk in workshops and things, I say, well, if you still feel you were unhappy with that performance, that's fine. The day you feel you are happy, stop playing music. Okay, that's my take on it all. Thank you.
Isn't this conference wonderful? First of all, we come in here and experience an emotional thing we never dreamed we'd experience coming in here, and then we get to think about things we never dreamed we'd think of. And we're only two-fifths of the way through. So, next, Ernie Watts.
Everything is sacred. Everything comes from the same source. Everything comes from the primal energy. So the values that we put on things are related to our individual concepts of how we deal with this energy. personally, for me, music being sacred ground happened over a period of time. As a kid growing up, I was just a kid growing up learning how to play the saxophone. In our culture, everything is a competition and a sport. So you want to be the best, you want to play the highest, you want to play the fastest, you want to be first chair, you want to win the auditions and blah-de-blah-de-blah, because that's the way our system is set up, right? Then you get a star on your forehead, you know. At a certain point, learning and studying and playing and, you know, trying to be the best related to other people's rules about what's the best, you know, because when you're a kid, that's what you're doing. You know, you're trying to be acceptable to people who are in positions of authority. So you're trying to be acceptable by them. To the degree that you are acceptable by them, therein lies your success. At a certain point, you find out that music and what we are and what it is so much larger. And when you make that acknowledgement and you walk through that door, everything changes, you know. I'll tell the same little story that I told yesterday, because it's one of my very favorites. There's a New Yorker magazine cartoon that was in the magazine years and years and years ago, and it was this cartoon character of two very, very rich older people in New York, and they're in this fantastic box at the theater or somewhere, you know. And the woman is looking at the man and she's saying, "Herbert, no one's winning. It's the ballet." So that kind of gives you the picture of where we're coming from. When you keep studying and you keep learning and you keep aspiring, at a certain point in your life, you realize that what you do is a part of something that's very large. It's a part of something else. And when you make a commitment to yourself to become a part of that, it changes the way you look at things. So for me, every time I play, it's a sacred experience, right? Because for me, what I believe individually is that universal energy works through us, as the artists, or works through all of us, but I think it's more clearly evident with the artists, you know, that the universal energy moves through us and works through us to bring beauty to this earth, to help make this sad place a better place. We're all a part of the same energy. We're all, you know, the Koch brothers are a part of this same energy. You know, they just are hooked in backwards. I'd say that, you know, I have a stepson who was totally out of line, you know, and everything was the other way. So I just consider that being a reverse polarity. You know, his polarity was reversed, right? His energy was working in a negative way rather than a positive way. It's the same energy, right? I'm a very compulsive person. Everything I do, I focus on and I obsess on. I almost kill myself with my compulsive energy, right? I got distracted. So I recognized that, and I had to take my compulsive energy and I had to change the polarity. So I'm just as crazy as I ever was, but I try to take my crazy energy and use it for consistently for a positive reason rather than a negative reason. So rather than doing myself in, I nurture myself. Same energy, right? It's how we use it. All of these things are related to the energy and how we use it and how we think. Everything, you know, there's this funny movie, and I think you all know it. What is it called? The History of the World, or, you know, it was Monty Python, and there was a little song in there called Every Sperm is Sacred. Sorry. Anyway, but there's all of these ways that people think. There's all of these ways that we think. So for me, my concept is everything that comes through us comes from spirit. Everything that we see is part of spirit. Everything that we do is part of spirit. And to the degree that you recognize that, it manifests for you on the physical plane, on the earth, you know, which brings us to it is done unto you as you believe, or your concept of reality is your reality, or what you think and what you feel manifests on the physical plane, which brings us to you're creating your future and your present by your thoughts, the things you think and the words you say create what you are. That's how the universe works, right? It's that kind of energy. So for me, music is very sacred. It became very sacred when I made that personal recognition of what our music is and what it's for, you know? So for me, I stepped out of the parade, right? Then the things that I do are related to that. You know, the things, your life, when you're a musician, your life is your music. You can't play something that you have not experienced. Your concept of your life is what comes through as your music. It's macrocosm, microcosm. It's all the same energy, once again, flowing. So when you make this recognition, everything becomes that. And then you choose what you want to believe. You choose what you want to believe. You choose what you want to think, because you know that what you think and what you believe is creating your tomorrow. So one of the first things that Patricia and I did were we turned off the TV. So that lifted, that helped to lift our consciousness very much, you know, because we weren't getting the dark energy that holds you down. You know, when you release the dark energy that holds you down, then your consciousness can rise and you can become more perceptive and responsive to, you know, higher forms of energy. It's a lot of energy, right? There's a lot of levels of energy because everything is vibration, right? If you go back and you study the ancient Indian religions, just about all the religions are dealing with velocity of energy, speed of vibration, right? We're on the third dimensional plane here, very slow vibration. That's why we're on the physical. This is the land of stuff. You know, it's all of these things that you hold that come from concepts and ideas. There's nothing here that was not somebody's idea, right? Everything was somebody's idea. So when you raise your vibration, it just brings you to different levels, different strata, right? Of ideas, and then your concepts rise. That's all a part of this sacred idea, this sacred music. If you look back on it, that was the purpose of music in the beginning. The purpose of music in the beginning was to be there for religious rituals, right? Mystery schools, for all kinds of ritual and ceremony. It was always generated by music because the music lifted people's consciousness to a point where they could see and visualize other things, and people would have awakenings, right? Along with a whole bunch of whatever else they were taking, right? Because they were all taking stuff too. You know, or they'd go hungry for 4 days and they'd walk out in the woods and starve themselves half to death, and they'd have a vision and they'd say that's their vision, you know. Mainly it's because they had low blood sugar. But they would have a vision, right? And that's how these things evolved. And I was looking around last night. I was thinking about Greeks and the mystery schools and all the ritual and all the ceremony. And we were over at Jane's house last night at her party, and we were playing, and I was looking out at all the people, and they were dancing and they were jumping around up and down and singing everything. And I said, nothing's changed, right? It's the same thing on a different level. Right? It's all some form of interaction generated by this energy that is music. And people were having a wonderful time, and it was a great thing, and we brought people joy in that way. You know? So there's all of those kind of things, because we're all related and we're all connected, and I think everything is connected and everything is sacred, related to our consciousness of it, our acceptance of it, and our walking into it, our doing the ballet, being involved in the ballet. So I think I should stop now.
Thank you. Takes us to Adrian.
You're going to make me follow that? He's like my guru. He's like 20 years more developed of exactly what I think. Well, I'm going to try to take an angle on this. I was thinking, and try this on. Life is empty and meaningless. And it's empty and meaningless that it's empty and meaningless. So what does that leave us with? Nothing and everything. You know, so we're born as little babies and we come out. And I mean, I know we've got genes and probably predispositions, but basically as an infant mind, we've really got nothing in there. You know, I've always kind of wondered what would happen if a human grew up in isolation on a desert island. But you left them with things like musical instruments or paper and a pen. What would come out of that? I mean, who knows? But we're kind of clean slates when we enter this world, and then we fill this emptiness, this beautiful emptiness, with stuff, stories, stories that we tell ourselves, and stories that others tell us, and others tell us their stories, and then we tell ourselves stories. And then we create this whole structure. You know, 100,000 years ago, we were foraging and picking berries, and we saw a shooting star, and we created a story about that being some god that's watching over us. Or and then a volcano erupted, and we told ourselves that that God was angry, and through this we created all these constructs about this mystical, these mystical realms of these other places, and you touched upon it in interesting ways by calling them dimensions, and you know, so music as sacred ground. Well, you know, we've touched on the sort of the religious sacred musics. Maybe I'll talk a little bit about my own version of sacred. And that in itself is just a word, right? And that word probably has as many subtleties in the, a variation of definition as there are people in this room. What does the word sacred mean? You know, for me, what sacred means is music, and only music, allows me to go to a place that's probably the closest that I can get to back to that place of true nothing, which is that place of true anything, that that place of possibility. You know, I used to think life is empty and meaningless. Well, that's a depressing notion. Well, you know, wasn't that what Sartre said? And meaning and nothingness. He came to that conclusion, and it depressed him, because he realized life was empty and meaningless, and then immediately made it mean something. So that true place of meaninglessness and nothingness is actually, I think, where the greatest freedom comes from, because it allows us to create possibility. And I mean, if that possibility is truly unencumbered by all the stories we tell ourselves, you know, you're 5 years old and someone tells you this, and then you decide, I'm there's something wrong with me. That's that first moment in your life where you say, there's something wrong with me. You know, other people are normal and I'm not normal. And we carry this with us. And then later on, when you're a teenager, more of these things start to accumulate. And then you become an adult and you realize, I'm on my own now with all these deficiencies. And I've got to create this construct of a personality so that the world accepts me and allows me to be a part of it. And it's really like this huge sort of construct that we create for ourselves. And I guess for me, getting to a place of nothing is most easily achieved through playing music. And it's, again, you talked about energy and vibrations. And I mean, when I'm having the greatest moments of playing music, I feel like I've disappeared. I feel like that almost literally, like in a physical sense, because I usually play with my eyes closed. You know, there's this sense of just dissolving into it. That's pretty sacred to me, because it almost feels like it takes me back to the place that, if you want to say, God intended us to be at, that's where it is. I mean, you know, you look at some of the spiritual teachings, you know, the Jesuses and the Buddhas. I mean, I think they all said the same thing. And then we went and added so many damn stories to it all that we turned it into, like, how does a guy like Jesus come along and basically say, love each other? That's really all he said, is we're all the same, let's love each other. How in God's name did that lead to 1,500 years later of charging through Europe, burning witches? And, you know, the crusade, like, how does that happen? I don't know. Our stories, we add stories, we make things mean things. But I just think that the simplicity of a lot of the messages that some of these great people were trying to tell us was that, you know, heaven is in the moment, and within the moment, when you're truly in the moment, there's really nothing there, and it's this beautiful space of possibility. And I mean, you know, the human race has been a beautiful expression of many possibilities. I mean, if you look at what we've created since we came here. So music is sacred ground. Well, I can't speak for anyone but myself. I just know for me it's the most sacred ground that exists, because when I can sit down and get inside of the space that I'm continually learning to go deeper into, it provides me with what I think is the most beautiful experience that a human can have, which is nothing and everything simultaneously. Thanks for having me here, because I've had a couple of those moments playing with you guys, and it's been beautiful and uplifting, so thanks.
And Tanya, your turn.
Ooh, I got a lot to follow.
You do.
Well, first, ooh, David. David had me crying already. That right there is what's sacred. When somebody can sing and make you feel it, to me, that's sacred. I pick songs so that when I sing them, my audience can feel it. And I never pick a song that I can't relate to or it doesn't have meaning, because I don't want to sing a song that doesn't have meaning. And to me, like when I was growing up in New Orleans, there's a place called Congo Square. And we were told that that was the sacred ground. I was raised in a Catholic home, so Congo Square was not a place that my grandmother and mama was bringing me at the time. I had to get there when I was a teenager to see what actually was going on. But now, my uncles, they pull out the congos and they pull out all the different percussions. And he studied African American art and culture and music. And what he does is he writes poetry. And they take the poetry and they play the congos, and he's so deep sometimes that I gotta pick up a dictionary to actually figure out the metaphors and all the different, what's the other word they use?
Allegories.
Allegories. And he does this thing called a haiku. Yeah. And it's like every day he posts a haiku, and I had to call him and say, what does that mean? You know what I mean? I mean, okay, that didn't make sense. And he was like, go pick up a dictionary. You know, that's what he does. I mean, my family is all about it. If you don't understand, we never had iPads and all that, because I'm 46. Nobody ever believes that, but I'm 46 years old. We had encyclopedias. We had the man that came to the door and wanted to sell you A through Z and stuff like that. And so, like, now, I mean, you know, you can ask Siri, but half the time, Siri don't understand what I'm saying when I'm asking her, you know? So I'm like, Siri, tell me. And she's like, you want me to play Alicia Keys? I don't have Alicia Keys on my phone, so that's not what I said. So, but the thing is, like Mr. Watts said, the world revolves, you know, it evolves. It you keep, every day you learn something new. Somebody's going to teach you something new. And this man right here, I knew nothing about him until I came here. And trust me, I told him I'm going to buy everything that he ever made. You know? And every panel I was on, he makes me cry. Oh. But I cry easy. Y'all know that, right? So, and Derek, he's a sweetheart. I mean, and he's very educational. I mean, I have to say, I learned so much from all of these gentlemen that it's knowledge. I feel like when it's sacred, it's good to sit in a circle and just listen. Mm-hmm. And you soak up all that knowledge. That, to me, is sacred. You know, y'all ask questions. Sometimes y'all ask questions I know nothing about. I've been on some panels with people that were anthropologists and I'm like, what am I on this panel for? I don't know nothing about. But then they'll say something that has something to do with my life, and I can relate to it, and I can just bring you a different aspect, maybe not with all the big words like they said, but, you know, in a more easier term, you know. But to me, when it comes to sacred music, I learned that when I went to a Baptist church one day, I cried and cried, and I kept saying, why am I crying so much? But it was like something the choir was doing, and that drum and that bass was doing this, and it felt like my body was doing this too. And I'm like, why am I moving like this, you know? And the choir just, they were like, boom, and my body was just moving with every word, and they were so loud but beautiful. And the way I was raised in a Catholic church, it was, you kneeling every 5 minutes, you're getting up, and, you know, it was very quiet, and wasn't all that singing and Lord, and Lord, and could get on up, and no, you was going to be shh. That's exactly how it was the whole time. So I used to sneak with some of my friends to their church. They would invite you and say, come on, a family and friend day, and then I'd come home, and Mom said, why your eyes so puffy? I'm like, I don't know. I just cried the whole service. But then I said, Lord, they be in church for 3 hours. I'm not used to that. You know, we was 45 minutes out. You was home, you know. I was like, and then I'm wondering why all the ladies in church had a purse full of candy and snacks and stuff. And so I realized that when I went to a Baptist church, I better bring me a little snack bag, too, because you was going to be in there for about 3 hours. I was going to cry. I had my napkins or whatever. I was going to wipe my eyes and be snacking like all the other ladies. So. But at the same time, I was feeling in the word, and I'm like, I like this, you know. So then I said, well, when I got in high school, I said, well, I want to join the gospel choir. So I got in my high school gospel choir, and then I started learning that the same songs that we were singing in the Catholic church, the Baptist church were doing them too. They just did them with a different feel, and those drums was making that feel come. So my uncle sat down and he explained to me, and he brought me into Congo Square, and he told me the story that, you know, back, he said, way before you was even thought of, child, that's how he said, you know, the African Americans used to come together here and they would chant. And he said the drums were their words, and they spoke through their words, through their drum. They didn't talk to each other. The music, the different instruments, was actually the conversation that was going on. And then I learned that our Indians, we have this thing called Super Sunday, where the Indians come out, and all the different tribes, they don't fight. They, what they call, they battle with the different, they want to see, I'm prettier than you, look at my outfit, you know. And to them, they sacred, and they do chants like the song, my grandma and your grandma were sitting by the fire. My grandma told your grandma, I'm going to set your flag on fire. And then the other one, one will have a flag boy, and the other one's going to have a flag boy, but they're trying to tell you that our colors are more sacred than yours. Our ground is more sacred, and we're going to fight for it. But they're not physically fighting. They want to show you that our outfit is beautiful. You know, look at our colors. They're trying to compete with the colors and all the different feathers. And to them, that was their sacred thing, to compete with each other as far as, look how much time and effort I put into all these different arrays of colors. So this is sacred to me, and I'm going to sing about it. And they talked about their flag boy, and they talked about Giacomo Finane. Everything was, all of those songs have a meaning, and all of them were actually battle songs. But they didn't fight physically. They fought either with the drum, or they fought with their words. And then they fought with their flags. Whoever had the most beautiful flag and can actually wear the other one out, you know? So that to them was sacred. So I started learning all the different things that were sacred to people that I knew nothing about. So I had to start respecting that, hey, you know, okay, I might not like your music for more than 15 minutes, but, you know, you might not like my music for more than 15 minutes, but I have to respect that this is the type of music that you like doing. And that's what made me respect what Mr. David Wilcox is doing. Because, I mean, I would never say I would go in the store and say, oh, I'm going to pick that up and see what that sound like. But he proved me wrong. That listen, and if you listen sometimes, you might enjoy. Sometimes you gotta sit back and soak up the knowledge and keep your mouth shut and just let another person give you
some education. And that's what I feel like I get here from all these gentlemen, because they've experienced much more things than I have, but they can now let me know that, hey, if you approach this, this might be the way you need to do this. It's by listening and respecting. And to me, when you respect a person's music and what they do, then you know that that's sacred to them. And then you have to respect the fact that what I do is sacred to me, just like what you do is sacred for you. So I feel like everybody has something that's sacred to them. And you should always give that other person respect. And you might not like what they have, or you might not want to be involved with what they're doing, but you still have to respect that. So I feel that that's what sacred is to me.
We're going to open it up for questions, so if you have a question, please come up to the microphone. I want to start by saying I think these five people prove why Conference on World Affairs is sacred for Boulder. Aww. You know, I don't know, but we're waiting for anybody that wants to ask a question. I'm curious, do you ever get to ask each other questions? Did anything that happened here today when you were listening to each other prompt one of you to want to ask a question of one of the other panelists? Go for it.
Wow, well, I mean, it's almost scary that I've heard so much. I actually approached this panel as thinking, well, this is the easy one, because, you know, we're all musicians, and music is sacred to us. What else can you say? And I've had my ears and eyes opened in so many different directions by this panel. It's been the most amazing panel for me, this one. What questions did I want to ask? No, I was really interested about you disappearing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Within the music, yeah. Because I like you, close my eyes when I play, yeah. And it's weird because I never fall off the stage or bump into things, but I do close my eyes, and I sometimes reach that similar kind of stage. That, I mean, was it a question? I just wanted to talk to you about that, because I thought I was the only one that just kind of almost disappeared, and I do hopefully disappear, and I talk about the invisible saxophone. Yeah. Which is for me, that's the nirvana I'm heading for. So it just is the thought process and the music. And if I can make the saxophone invisible, all the technical aspects of it, then that's the nirvana I'm looking for. So maybe that was the nothingness that you actually talked about, but I've never considered it as nothingness. Yeah. Sorry, I just opened up, that, you know, it made me think.
Yeah.
Yes, if you can come up to the microphone. But keep talking.
Yeah, I don't know. Isn't there a Buddhist term like transmutation? And I mean, I remember someone showing me this exercise where, like, if you have a headache, does anyone have a headache right now? Like, so there was this technique where you shift your perception, your attention to the headache, but you don't judge it. You just observe it, not with any commentary. You just literally observe it, like, you know, like, I don't know, like, I'm looking at that glass. I'm just looking at it, and somehow that process of acknowledgement causes the disappearance of that actual thing.
Yes, his singing, when my head was pounding, and when he started singing, I closed my eyes and I'm like, okay, and then all of a sudden I started feeling what he was singing, and then my eyes started watering. I said, uh-oh, I'm about to start crying, you know? But, I mean, like you said, when you close your eyes and make people disappear, the reason how I had to make myself I'm still get stage fright, because the day that I don't get a butterfly is, like he said, I better stop singing, because you have to always have that anxiousness. But you know what I used to do, and I still do it. I'm sorry, I'm gonna give you my secret. I imagine all of y'all in y'all underwear, so so that keeps me, like, you know, so, you know, I don't get as, you know, stage fright as much. I mean, I've been doing it for years, but I still get butterflies, you know, because you want to make sure you enjoy it, you enjoy what I'm doing. So I just imagine y'all either naked or in your underwear.
I've loved hearing all of you speak, and I I would love to hear more about pocket. Now, this is a spiritual thing. When I play guitar and I'm singing, I'm thinking too much. And you can tell, because when I'm singing, I'm like, my head's too far forward. But there's a thing that I call bass face. If you watch a bass player and he does this, what's going on? It's like heart first into the world. And there's a thing that I have experienced when I play bass, and I love to play bass, but I don't perform with it because I can't carry it around. But I have this feeling of when I finally felt what pocket was, and this is a mystical thing. Pocket is the opposite of trying to play in time. Pocket is like when time changes. Even if you're playing to a click, if you're in the pocket, you have the perception that if you slowed down, the click would slow down. You just have this thing about like time is different. And that's why it's not like trying to balance a ball on the top of a hill, like trying to get your note on the beat. No, it's like it's sitting there. It ain't going nowhere. You couldn't play out of time if you wanted to. And there's this lovely feel when you're in the pocket, you realize that rhythms don't go round an even circle. It's this wonderful sort of, it's like the cartwheel is egg-shaped and it gives you this kind of heartbeat. And you're like, and it's just this life. It's like the blood pulsing through your veins. It's just this feeling of like when you're in it, you're not thinking about it. And for me, my experience of pocket, since I'm not good at it, is like, I'll be playing this thing and I'll think, oh man, I'm in the pocket. And immediately, of course, I'm out. So when you start to get there, it's like, don't think, just pull your head back and let your heart go first into the world.
I think athletes, a lot of people call that being in the zone. Being in the zone is when everything is right, you know, and for music, that is what we aspire to. That's why we practice. You know, you practice so much that you get so into your instrument that you don't have to think about it when you play it. It's like having a conversation. You don't think of where you're going to put your tongue when you say the word "the," when you announce the T, because if you had to think of what you did with your tongue to make every word, you wouldn't be able to have a conversation. Music is a conversation. Music is singing a song. The instrument is a tool that we use to sing our song. And so the instrument has to be totally invisible, right? We talk about it going invisible, right? The way I think about it is when you play music, when you get into the zone, you become music. And the music plays you. The Holy Spirit sings through you. And everything is right. And everything's the way it's supposed to be because you're in line with the universe. So, there you go.
Okay, back here we have a question. But wait, we got one first, Victor. Yeah.
With Tanya and with Derek, come to the mic.
They're recording, yes, it'd be helpful to be at the mic.
And Derek, one of the things I learned, my grandfather was in the Chicago Symphony Orchestra in first chair and played well. And scary and sacred, how it comes together and what it means. And I say that because of Rachmaninoff or Clair de Lune, which is sacred when I hear it. But scary is who let the dogs out. Okay? When I first heard that, I said, man, that's terrible. And I listened to the lyric and I thought about it and I said, you know, Herbie Mann moves me. Ray Brown moves me. And as I see it and hear you talk, I know that the instrument is not a tool, but a person. It becomes part of you. The Stradivarius, the saxophone, Ray Brown with the bass. First time I heard him, I said, why haven't I heard him before? I heard him when I was 60. Well, I didn't hear him when I heard Clair de Lune. So sometimes we move with sacred and scary, and we go back and forth. Then I thought about you, Tanya, and I said, I'd love to hear you sing Amazing Grace.
I'm going to jump in just so that Tanya, because, you know. There's an interesting thing. It's just making me think, you talking about that. We as, I know probably Ernie's been through this with me. I know he's totally settled where he is on his equipment. But as saxophone players, we're on this eternal quest for the right mouthpiece and the right saxophone and the right reed. And once you get a good reed, it wears out. All the saxophone players I know, we obsess about it, and we've got boxfuls of mouthpieces at home. We tried this one, and we tried that one. And actually, the answer is, you're going to sound like what you're going to sound like, whatever you're playing. That is. So, as much as I think, I want to be able to play like Ernie Watts, I want to be able to play like Ben Webster, I want to sound like David Sanborn, I want to make a noise like Cannonball Adderley. I can't. I'm going to make a noise like Derek Nash. And that's the only choice I've got. So find the equipment that makes Derek Nash... She's sound, easy to come out. And that's kind of advice to almost music students and people throughout life. Something Ernie was just saying, I suddenly thought of an analogy which I use, which is, you all drive cars, yeah? So when you learn to drive, you crunch the gears and the steering wheel and the clutch and all of that. Now you just get in the car and you look at the road and you enjoy the road. And sometimes the road gets twisty and turny if it's a road you've never been down. But you don't even think about what you do with your hand and your body, do you, when you're driving the car? And that's almost like it is when you're playing jazz in a way, that the learning of the thing is all the practice and the thing there. And then you can actually have a really enjoyable journey because of all the subconscious stuff that's going on and that you've learned. And I kind of somehow, I like to relay that analogy because it almost gets across what we do. Do you actually all do the same thing? You do it in cars. We do it with saxophones.
Yeah, when we play, it's like flying. It's an out-of-body experience.
Yes, thank you.
I just wanted to say that I just realized that scared and sacred are actually anagrams of each other.
Ooh. That's cool. So the subject today is music is sacred ground, and I've been a musician for over 30 years and a teacher for over 25, and it's very sacred for me. Probably saved my life. There's a quote by Joseph Campbell. He's quoting his wife, actually, Jean Erdman, who was a renowned choreographer. Yeah, and she says, the difference between the mystic and the artist is the artist has a craft. And the definition of mystic that I really like is one who by contemplation or surrender seeks to become one with the deity or the absolute. And you spoke about what I call a transparent quality of being. And that's always been my favorite aspect. When I get into the music, it's very early on, that first experience of disappearing. And then practicing and practicing so I could become... I could do more complex music and still disappear into it and not have it conscious. And this being a musician, being an artist, being like the mystic, that being our path to disappearing into this, the consciousness, into this, the nothingness, which I really don't think of as nothing, but just nothing we can describe.
It's what you think. If you think it's nothing, it's nothing. If you think it's everything, it's everything. It's all consciousness.
And I think a musical note says it even better, right?
Right. Well, you know, the thing with instrumental music is you play, it's a song that comes through you, it's the concept that comes through you, but then everyone that hears it gets to think of their own story. Everybody gets to make up their own story when they hear you play. So it's nonverbal communication, but it's, what would you call it, interactive.
Yeah, and I like the term transconceptual.
Right.
It's beyond concepts.
Yeah. So, you know, when you sing the blues and you say, my baby done left me and I wish that I was dead, right? Everybody understands my baby done left me and I wish that I was dead, right? If you play the blues, then people might think about their mother or their kids or something that happened, you know?
Yeah.
That kind of thing. So for me, that kind of takes it to a personal choice thing that keeps everybody's wheels turning, you know, because we're all dealing with our concepts.
Right.
Yeah.
Great. And I just wanted to toss that pebble in the pond to all of you, that we all have a craft. Whatever we're doing is a craft, whether we're playing music or
I had a great teacher say, you know, don't forget what you're doing is also a craft. Like a craftsman, you have to get the tools, and you have to learn how to. But you know, in my case, it's learning the mechanics of the piano. I can be as spiritual about music as I want, but if I can't physically execute on that instrument, I'm not even going to get into that space that we're describing, right? So, I mean, you know, getting all mystical and spiritual about it doesn't let you off the hook. In a way, you have to actually work even harder at it from a craftsman standpoint in order to afford yourself the clearing to get into that magical place. So, yeah, you still got to practice your scales and you still got to, you know.
It's freedom through discipline.
Yeah.
It's freedom through discipline.
Right, and then that's the respect that I say, like, I have for them, because when they're playing something that a singer's not singing, they have to actually deliver with the singer that should be right there in the mic. They're right. The singer now. So I sometimes want to walk up to them and say, you really know the words of that song? You know what I mean? But and sometimes they do stuff with the horn, like, I wish I could do that with my voice, you know? But they deliver it a different way, and you have to have a respect for that, because they're showing you that, hey, I can show you something that you can't do with your voice, you know, but I'm going to do it right now with my horn. And that make you sit down and soak up that knowledge and say, hey, next time I'm singing, maybe even see if I can curl that note a little bit, like he played on a sax last night, or like Miss Durney was playing when I played Aretha. He played something on a break on a solo, and I said, next time I sing that, let me see if I can make that note do that next time, you know? So, and, you know, it's with anybody who plays, a guitar player, anybody who takes a solo, the soloist is sitting there going, I wish I could do that, you know? But you can't, you know, you can't tune up this like they can tune up, and then some of the notes they hit on a sax, you're like, oh, no, I could never, that will never happen, you know? Unless somebody come poke me, and I'm like, ah! You know what I mean? But no. You know, so you have to respect their craft.
All right. Yes.
Derek, you were talking about a difficult kind of value judgment. You said somebody said you did really well. He really loved what you did as you performed, and you said, I give myself a C- or something. And I want to know what is more sacred, the sacredness of your self-criticism or the sacredness of a person listening to your music's appreciation of your music?
That was a...
Okay. For me, it's still my own self-fulfillment of how well I played. That's the most sacred thing for me, because that, to me, is the most important thing. Anybody that actually gets some pleasure out of what I do, that's the bonus, that's the cream on the cake. But if I'm not happy, it means I will constantly pursue to make myself even better. So for me personally, my own performance is the most sacred thing, and my own value judgment. I'm probably my own worst critic, although some other people have written some nasty... No. But no, for me, it's all about I want to do the best that I can of me. You know, it's a personal, I'm on this race course and I'm never ever going to give up trying to improve myself, to better myself, to be that. I think if you ask most musicians, you know, when was the last time that you were really satisfied with what you did? That was, you know, I couldn't play any better than that. And I think I kind of get, I don't even know if it's one tune a gig. It might be one chorus a gig. When I actually think, yeah, I nailed that. That was good. I was proud of that one. That one came out, and that idea, I thought it, and it came out the horn, and then something, and then I sparked off. But most of the time, I will always be self-critical. So for me, no, my own performance is more sacred. I don't have any rights over the sacredness of your listening experience. That's not. I don't have the right to. I can't. No, I don't have the right. That's your listening experience. If I can some way give you any enjoyment by what I do, that's a huge bonus. But no, for me, the personal goal and personal journey I'm on is me trying to get better and better at what I do.
Yes. It's not possible to do that through appreciation, because if you're downloading something through the universe as a conduit, it seems like that conduit would open bigger through appreciation.
Look, we're all musicians, we're all rampant egotists, and we all love people coming up after the gig and saying, yeah, that was great, wow, that was fantastic, come on, it's lovely, it's an amazing thing to do. For me, actually, the salient things for me is not necessarily an audience response at the end of the night, but there have been moments in my life where people have come back to me and said, your album's so special. I had a lady last year, we played a particular tune when we got married. Now, to have actually, that my music meant so much to somebody else that they got married to me. I don't mean got married to me, I mean... they got married to a piece of my music. Now, that was a sacred experience, because I felt so honoured and venerated that... Because I'm just, you know, I have a funny sort of thing about my music. My music is my children. Takes about 9 months to make an album. You're going to send it out in the world. You're always going to be proud of it. But some people will love them, and some of them will be really successful, and some of them might not be very successful at all. But you're always going to love them whatever, and you're always going to be proud of them, and you're always going to nurture them and look after them. And when you're gone, that's all that's left to carry on.
Yeah. We have time for one more question.
Okay, we've been talking about the conversation of music and how you guys converse amongst yourself and talk about the basis of having an understanding of the language, how to form your tongue when you speak, how you do these things. But what I find interesting, and I've been thinking a lot about this, is when would you comment on how music is sacred? Because not just the technical aspects or how you channel it to us, but then how is it that all the rest of us as human beings can emote with that music? Because we've had nothing to do with the process of making it, and yet we understand it so fully and so fundamentally. And so is that not the sacredness of the music?
We're all part of the same energy, like I was saying before. So when we play the music and it comes through us and it comes to you, it touches a common bond. It touches that thing that we're all made of. The thing that we're all a part of comes out and touches you. You know, I use a little analogy of E.T., you know, with his little heart beating, and then he gets weak, you know. We go through life and we get so conditioned, and we get so much luggage, and we get so many concepts and ideas dumped on us, and we have so much fear, and we have so much anger, and we're so alone that we forget. And that's the problem that our whole culture has. That's our whole problem that the whole world has. We have forgotten. We are all children of this energy. We are all part of this energy, whatever you want to call it. I call it, you know, the universal spirit or the Holy Spirit. You can call it God. You can call it anything you want to call it. There is this one ineffable thing that goes through all things that no one has ever been able to put a word on. you know, Moses said, I am, you know. There's a lot of ways to think about that. But very, very basically and very, very simply, we are all a part of the same thing. So that when you hear this music and it fills you full of joy, or if you cry, or however it affects you deeply, that's that soul aspect of what you are. That's that energy, that's that common bond, and that is what's sacred.
Yeah. And we are out of time. Thank you, Ernie, for a great conclusion. I would like to say that, as far as I'm concerned, this panel was in the pocket. Thank you.
Well said.
Thanks, guys.
It's because I've been there.